Just a moment, please. I'm requesting all of you to please mute your mics because this session is getting recorded. So I don't want the disturbance in between. If you have questions, we can discuss later. So just to give you summary of this session is going to be 40 minutes long, 35 minutes I am going to discuss, and last 5 minutes we'll have the communication. Second part of this series is going to be on Monday, 10 o'clock. A few of you are sending me messages, but I am not able to concentrate on the messages right now because I am concentrating on what I want to deliver. Of course, you may be having some issues with listening. The voice may not be coming, but you may change some settings in your phone or laptops, what you are doing, because from here I have made everyone able to listen. Right, so let's start the implants in atrophic jawbone. Why we have selected this point?
Earphones are partma.
Please mute your mics. Please.
Earphones are partma. Mar seminar chal.
Why we have selected this topic is because everyone is facing this issue that bone is not there. You want to do something, but there's an issue. So we thought let's discuss from the platform of World of 32 Dental Institute. Let's discuss about what we can do in case of atrophic jawbone. So what are the considerations? So I would like to go from the basic to further. And we will discuss more and more points together. So let's go further. Number one, I want to clarify first that the cases you are going to see, the photos, the videos you are going to see, there's no Photoshop is being done except cropping. We don't have any conflict of interest with anyone in our city, our state, in our country or in the world. And these are my own opinions. It may vary from others. There may be different or better techniques to do the same type of cases. So I am sharing what I believe, and definitely we can change the perspective, and together we can learn more. This is where we were practicing. I would say not are, we were practicing. I don't know from by what time we will be able to reach there. This is our clinic where we practice, and this is how we were practicing before a few days, and it's all now everybody is at home, right? Coming to the practice of implant, why people hesitate to introduce implants in their menu of the services they provide? Of course, majority of you must be practicing, but still there may be dilemma that why people are not frequently giving the options. Number one, they have the mindset that people don't pay in our area. So I agree with you that always as a consumer, people don't want to pay. Even if something is available at some cost and if something is available at a cheaper cost, then definitely people will at least go for what is happening at a cheaper cost. So it's a human mentality. It's a consumer mentality. We all belong to that group. So don't keep that barrier to your mindset. People pays, and there has to be value for money. They see their value for money. Once they see the value, they will pay. People believe that my practice is anyway great. Why to unnecessarily complicate my life by introducing implant? I am able to extract the teeth and make the bridges, full mouth bridges. And why implants? Why to introduce so much investment? The training, that part of complications and a lot of other things. So they don't allow the implants to come in. Sometimes your consultants are very good. And I'm 100% agree that the efficient person, the teamwork helps. But when you're working in some part of country where you have a remote area where consultants can't come daily basis, or other part, your patients also believe that if you are doing personally would be better. And if they will say that, sir, agar aap kar rahe hain to koi bahar se kyun aayega. So once you are doing yourself, it always helps. They don't want to take unnecessary risk, right? So I would like to clarify here that any single procedure in dentistry is having the risk. Even the consultation part is having the risk, right? Patient may die on your consultation chair by some other reasons. You are giving a local anesthesia, and there may be so many complications of local anesthesia. You have prescribed some medicine, and there may be some allergies. Patient may get hypoglycemic by doing root canal treatments while filling. So many risks are involved in our field. So implant is one of them. So don't consider it's a risky procedure. It's a very, very safe procedure. And people believe from small cities that why should I start? Anyway, people are going to the bigger cities for bigger treatment. So we need to come out of it, and we need to start further. Ajit bhai, koi che, mute karo please. Right? Let me go from basic to further. What exactly happens in conventional implant approach? Usually you have a failing tooth. You remove the tooth, or somebody has done for you, and you have the socket which is healing. It gets healed completely. You have the bone. After removal of the tooth, you have the socket. The socket starts healing. You wait for the healing, or patient has came after some time of extractions, and you have this healed socket. Now you are planning for an implant placement at bone level. Just to summarize the things you already know, right? And then you wait for the osseointegration time to heal properly. After some time, you go for second stage, put gingival former, and then you plan for impression, and finally the abutment stage comes, and on top of that you fix the crown. Maybe it's cement retained, maybe it's screw retained, maybe different type of processes. This is a conventional approach what we usually follow. But before we convince our patients, our mindset needs to be convinced first that yes, if by chance, unfortunately, I am losing a tooth, I will go for implant. I will never go for a bridge. I will never go for the option that I leave that. I have seen so many dentists that they are missing the teeth and still they have never opted for the replacement. I have seen so many. Right? Why we need to introduce implants? Why? Right? Because so many Gadijis, you can welcome, right? It saves your time, similar amount of money you want to earn through the routine general practice, and the similar amount of money you can earn from less time with dental implants. You have comfort, as you all are having right now, right? And a red carpet among your colleagues. Of course, there is a upper level you will feel when you are doing something which is your mindset was having the barrier. So ultimately, what I am concerned is the time to gain ratio is very good with implants. The time you invest for learning, or the time you invest in the dental clinic on the chair, and the gain you are having, maybe monetary gain, maybe goodwill gain, it is always good in case of implants. So we are opting for the implant. But the common problems, what I feel, what you may be feeling, that the patients who are having bone, they don't have money. And the patients who have money, they don't have bone. Patients who have both, they have some medical limitations, or maybe chain smokers. Or if everything is fine, sometimes you feel inferior that, well, whether I'll be able to do it or not. Let's go safe. Let's do something different. Let's not go further. So this is a common thought process people are having when it comes to your implant practice. Most commonly people come away. There are other factors also we can add to it, but as of now, I'm limiting to it. Right? We all know what happens when tooth goes. This is the diagram we always show in our courses, in our lectures, that this is the diagram everyone must have in their consulting room. You have to show this diagram to the patient, that what happens exactly when one tooth goes, There is a drifting of the neighbor teeth, supra eruption, chances of class 2 cavities developing in the neighbor teeth, the perio problems, the occlusal issues, and the TMJ issues later on. So there is a long chain of consequences which can happen if patient doesn't go for replacement. So this is something I recommend to show to the patients every time once it comes with a missing tooth. The story of implant comes later, but this it starts from here. And this is the consequences which really happens. Right. Another point we always discuss in our course is the dentures, particularly RPDs, the removable partial dentures. I would say the ratio of implants in your practice, the number of implants you do in your practice, the ratio is, it is inversely proportional to the number of RPDs you are making. So if you want to elevate the implant practice in your career, in your clinic, then you have to reduce the number of RPDs you are doing. As far as our practice is concerned, we don't make flippers. Very rarely we make cast partial dentures. Otherwise, we consider ourselves and we project ourselves as fixed specialists. So we don't want those RPDs in our practice because we never enjoyed. And I hope you also have never enjoyed RPD practice and your patients also have never got satisfied fully with the flippers. So why to do those things? And anyway, there is a very, very scientific background behind those RPDs that they induce bone loss. The dentures induce a lot of bone loss. And as the topic is there that the atrophy of the bone, or we want implants in the atrophic bone. So we need to understand what exactly is this atrophy and how it happens and why, how we can reduce it or how we can predict it. This is a common diagram everybody has seen in Kyle Misch, right? That the atrophy usually starts from the buccal side or the facial side. So initially the width gets reduced, and then if it continues, it reduces the height of the bone. As it goes further, it is more and more atrophic in height and width, and ultimately some basal bone left, and gradually the basal bone also gets atrophic. So this is how the atrophy follows. So we need to understand, we have to predict the atrophy before even going for the x-ray, that where, how much atrophy would be there in that particular case. So how can we predict it? Number one, how long patient is being edentulous? That is number one. And second, who has removed the tooth? Whether it is you, you know how traumatic extraction you have done last time. If you have not done, if you know someone in your area that, this person has done, you may be knowing their skills. And no, if this doctor does the extraction, it must be a very skillful extraction, atraumatic extraction. And you may be knowing in the reverse also. Right. So atrophy, atraumatic extraction induce maximum atrophy. So the traumatic extraction with the buccal movement and the squeezing of the socket, it induces maximum atrophy later on. What are the forces of the occlusion we need to understand? Patient who grinds or clenches the teeth, they have maximum occlusal forces. And when it comes to the dentures in the edentulous patients, they exert very, very less forces, like 50 psi compared to 1000 psi in case of clenchers. And the patients who are wearing CD for more years, long time, right? Then definitely they are going to have very, very less chewing power. So you need to convince our patient with these scientific facts that though you are okay, you need implants, particularly the atrophic jaw patients. This is a decision making chart in our implant case, implant practice. Usually how you should go. The first, in a conventional approach, at what level of practice you are in implantology, that is more important. If you are beginner and have the least experience, you go step by step. So you extract the tooth, you wait for the site to heal, then you place implant, then you wait for the implant to heal completely, and then go for the prosthetic loading. As you are upgrading your skills and confidence and equipments and infrastructure and training, then you may shorten the time of the treatment and you place the implant immediately after extraction, so you are reducing the healing time of the socket. Then maybe you are waiting for the healing and second osseointegration, and later on going for the processes. Or if the case demands, or if you are confident, skilled enough, then you may go for loading immediately, right? So how to identify an implant case in the practice? How should be our counseling? How should be our consultation? What we are looking for? Let's discuss few things in that. Those who have joined late, I am telling you, this is a 40 minutes presentation, 35 minutes I am going to speak. Last 5 minutes we will discuss the cases, and there will be end of part one. Part two is going to be on Monday, 10 a.m. The link will be shared again, so you can share with your friends. And again, it's a first 100 people accommodation in that case. So what is the implant consultation? There's a series of presentations. So we will end our first presentation at particular point after 35 minutes, and we'll continue from there in the next day. So it is advisable that you be in the stream. So what we believe is implant consultations should be. Of course, everybody knows that proper history, proper examination, proper photography, everything. Let's summarize. Number one, their past dental history. What you are looking for from the past dental history? We always ask from that, what time you went to the dentist last time? Because it shows you, it gives you idea that how serious the patient is regarding their dental health. The frequency of dental visits, whether patient goes only at the time of pain, or maybe they are regularly visiting and they respect to their doctors and their own oral health. Whether they have any bad experiences, because many patients avoid treatment because they had last experience very bad, and they believe that dentistry is like that one. So we need to change their mindset of the experience also. Whether they have any adverse habits. Nowadays, many people are heavy, and sometimes masala and gutka people nowadays don't consider them as a bad habit. No, I don't have a bad habit, right? So they will give you the wrong history. You have to identify. Then comes the medical history. What is medical history is important all about. If you ask a patient, do you have diabetes? No. If you ask a patient, do you have hypertension? No. Then will you ask them whether you take any medicine? Yes, I am taking medicine for blood pressure. I am taking medicine for diabetes. So you have to go a little in further. Of course, if they are taking medicines for hypertension, they don't have hypertension. So they are right from one side. So we need to go in the depth of the things. Blood thinners. We need to identify, ask them whether you are taking aspirin, clopidogrel, or any other type of things to make the blood thin. Whether they have gone through any radiations, whether they have any bleeding disorder, and the important thing, whether they have any rheumatoid factor or rheumatoid arthritis. Right, many people will say, okay, I am having the pain in the joints, chronic pain, but you need to go further because rheumatoid arthritis will change your treatment plan. Right, you need few x-rays, which are they? Then the IOPS you need OPG, and in few cases you need CBCT. At least you need an OPG for a case of implant. Then come some laboratory investigations. What laboratory investigations you need to go for an implant case? Now here I am telling, clarifying, not all cases in our practice also we are sending the patient for lab investigations. But when you have any doubts, please go for basic investigation. When you have a patient with history of diabetes, you have to go for full sugar profile. At least these are the list I have given. You need to go for CBC, sugar profile, BTCT, creatinine and alkaline phosphatase. When you suspect something, there's other list of investigations also come, but at least this is a basic thing you can go for the basic case. Then comes the role of diagnostic cast and photos. So what is that? What is diagnostic cast? Patient comes for the missing tooth. Sir, kya hoga iska? How to go for replacement? How much it is going to cost? We need to make them understand that we never gives you treatment plan without studying your case properly. You will get all the answers. This is how we tell our patients. That you will get all the answers. As a doctor, I know what my patient wants to know. That you need to know what is the treatment plan, how much is the cost, how much time it is going to take, how many visits it is going to take, whether there are any complications associated with that. Are there any options other than what I am going to suggest? I will give you all the answers. Let me finish my workout. Let me have study. I am not the doctor who just put the x-ray on the against the tube light and will tell the treatment plan. You always study. See, there are advantages of doing this thing. There is always, you can give yourself a second chance of second opinion. You may ask your friends. You may see it at a ease time, at your comfortable time. In your rush of OPD, you may miss something. So it is always better to take cast. You may tell your assistant doctor or associate to take the impressions, to take the photographs, to take the bite, the proper videos, how the occlusion is happening, how the movement of the jaw is happening. Take front portrait photo, because once you are starting doing it, you will be having a lot of cases in your computer. So you must be having a kiska cast, because you will remember the cast but don't remember the patient's photo. So you need to have it. And at the last, once you have everything, the next visit you are planning to discuss with the patient, right? Everything, I would tell that this is a presentation. It's not just a discussion. It should be presented, right? The first thing, everything needs to be on paper. You need to be having a paper, plain paper and a pencil or pen. If possible, you can use your computers, right? You need to be having your success stories of your old patients, right? And exact quotation. Patient will ask you how much. Then you must be absolutely ready in your mindset, or you may be having written somewhere just to hand over to the patient that yes, you need to do this. So everything should be there, exact duration, visits. The treatment plan must be completely fixed in your treatment, in your mindset. Possible questions, what patient is going to ask you. So the answers or the options for that also, we are going to discuss with them. At this point, we need to understand which are the strict contraindications for implant treatment. Number one, right now, any NRI patient, you all believe me, right? You all will agree. For next 3-4 months, you will not touch NRI patient, because every time before, otherwise some patient comes from outside, we usually welcome them gracefully. But nowadays, there is a bit of something. Please mute your mics, those who have not done yet. Recent radiotherapy for one and another cause. Untreated intraoral pathology or malignancy. If you see any pathology in their OPG, if you see any pathology in their CBCT near the site of implant you are planning, please, please don't go further. Right? Uncontrolled drug or alcohol use. You should not. I am again repeating myself, please, please close down your dental clinics. I can yet see the videos of few of the participants in this webinar. They are in the dental clinic and with their patients. It's a high time. You can earn later if you are alive and healthy. Please stay home and please let other people, your staff and patients, be at home. Please don't work from the clinic. Coming to the strict contraindications, uncontrolled drug or alcohol use. What to ask to the patient? What to ask to the patient of alcohol and how much is uncontrolled? It's always an issue. Right? So, uncontrolled psychiatric disorders. Please mute your mic. Please. This is literally distracting me from my topic, what I am discussing. And if you are a little busy, please